Oh, it's good to see you this evening. You guys are so faithful. I just love it. Every time I see you guys, I'm thinking, the faithful crew. So, did you bring your Bibles? Okay, let's open them up to the book of Ezekiel. Ezekiel, we'll see how far we get tonight. It's another long book. I'm not going to try to predict how long it's going to take me to get through it, but you guys know better than to believe me anyway. If you're visiting us tonight, we call this Bible study Route 66 because there's 66 books in the Bible and we're making our way through them in 66 years. Exactly. Hey, what's the hurry? If the Lord returns and we're just studying his word, that's a good thing, right? That's all. So, okay, well, hopefully you've made your way there. Ezekiel, one of the major prophets, of course. Remember, we have been sort of, in terms of history, we have been learning about the Babylonian captivity. And remember, Jeremiah predicted that it was going to happen. And there were false prophets saying, nah, it's not. And they were saying, it's peace, peace, everything's okay, just relax, you know. And Jeremiah said, oh, no, it's not okay. Judgment is coming. We're going to be taken captive into Babylon. And it took a while. The northern kingdom of Israel was captured by the Assyrians, and they had seen that whole thing go down many years before, about 100 years prior, and now it was their turn. And the fact that God delays his judgment doesn't mean judgment won't come. It just means he's very merciful, and he loves you, and he warns, and he's patient and long-suffering, and he continues to preach. Like Tad was saying tonight in his prayer, just that idea that God's drawing us to repentance, and it's his goodness and his kindness that's drawing us to repentance. And so this is God's heart. So all through the prophets, just keep in mind, there's a really... you know, we see God's judgment, but all through it, there's this redemptive theme. And remember the reason God had the prophets write it all down. Why did he have them take the time to put this down? Because when they were in captivity, he didn't want them to lose heart. He wanted them to look back and remember that that all of God's promises are true. When he promises judgment, guess what? Judgment is coming. But he also promised restoration. And so as they're going through this season of captivity, they still had an opportunity to repent. They were reaping what they sown. You know, there's still, it doesn't mean, okay, we're not going to have this chastening season. They were still going to go through a time of chastening. But he wanted future generations to know that he wasn't going to be angry forever. He was going to bring them back into the land. He was going to restore them. His heart was a heart of mercy. And so that's what Jeremiah, what Isaiah, what Ezekiel, what Daniel, all the prophets, that's what they were warning of. And I'm so glad they put it down also, not just for the sake of those people, but for you and me. Remember, Paul says in the New Testament, he says, these things were written in the Old Testament. This stuff was here for our instruction. So even in this church age, this age of grace, so we can look back and we can learn the lessons, because guess what? We can be naughty too, and we need a spanking too sometimes. And, you know, and we can lose heart. We can start to think that God's just going to be, you know, angry forever, and, you know, that's it. We've used up all his grace and mercy. And as long as we're alive, God tells us in his word that we have opportunity to repent. We don't know how long we'll be alive, but if you're still breathing and you're struggling with sin even yet, God just continues to call you to repentance. And man, I'm just more and more impressed with the mercy heart of God the more that I study the prophets. Well, Ezekiel wrote this book and prophesied during the Babylonian captivity. And though he was a priest, he was taken captive from Jerusalem to Babylon as a young man, okay? Before he was actually old enough to serve in the priesthood. Now, in Israel, you had to be 30 years old. So this was a bit before that, probably about 25 years old. And he ministered from 593 to 571 BC. If you're interested to know that historically, Ezekiel prophesied at the same time as Jeremiah and Daniel. So they were contemporaries. Daniel was the one taken captive first. Remember, there were three sort of deportations, and Daniel was taken with the first wave. And he ended up serving in the capital city of Babylon, and we're going to learn about that in the next book in Daniel. And that, boy, I'll tell you what, Daniel's such a fun book. We're going to love Daniel. Ezekiel was taken in the second wave, okay? And he lived not in the capital city, but about 200 miles north of Babylon. And Jeremiah was left in Jerusalem. As the city was destroyed in the third Babylonian siege, and so he would come later. During the time of Ezekiel, as I said, many false prophets predicted that Jerusalem would not be destroyed and that the captives would soon be returned to their land. And so the people were holding out hope that this was going to be short-lived. It wouldn't be long. We're going to be back home soon. But both Ezekiel and Jeremiah predicted a long captivity and tried to prepare God's people for that future. Ezekiel was a very interesting guy, sort of a colorful character, we're going to find. Rather than just speaking his prophecies, he liked object lessons. He liked drama. He liked to act things out and attract attention to God's messages. Actually, I don't know if he liked it. God just said, do it. And he said, yes, sir. it's interesting. God, how many of you have learned that God has his ways of communicating? Sometimes he uses a little drama in your life. You know, he likes gentler forms. He likes to just speak. Have you listened? Sometimes I tell my kids, when they were young, I would say, when they just weren't listening, I would sometimes say, Daddy's using words right now. I have other ways of communicating. And they would, they start scrambling around. Okay, we know that other way. We don't want that other way, you know. So I think God does that too. Anyway, Ezekiel pronounced God's judgment, and it was a hard message. It really was. It's a hard message to deliver. Do you ever have to deliver bad news? Nobody likes to deliver bad news. If you do, you probably shouldn't be the one delivering it. You might get some bad news coming your way, you know, if you misrepresent the Lord by being happy about, you know, other people's trouble. But that being said, it was a difficult message. But he also prophesied of God's faithfulness and his ultimate deliverance for Israel. God understands that there are some truths that are just going to be hard to swallow, but he makes the medicine go down a little easier by giving us hope and reminding us that he's going to get us through it. He repeatedly used the phrase, and I think, I might have not done the math quite right, I think like 67 times in this book you read the phrase, they shall know that I am the Lord. So I think it's kind of a theme. They shall know that I'm the Lord. In other words, the point, the big idea in the book of Ezekiel is God is God. Okay? That's really basic to understand, but apparently we need reminding on a regular basis. They did too. That's God's message to those who were under his judgment. I am the Lord. But again, he always wanted to bring his people back to an acknowledgement of himself. Now, Ezekiel's prophecies not only depict the judgment that had occurred to Israel, but they also looked into the future, actually to the first and second comings of Jesus Christ and the judgments that would accompany those times. And although the prophecies of judgment are clearly pronounced throughout this book, the character of God comes through loud and clear, and his glory is going to be seen in a profound way. That's another thing that you'll see through the whole book is the repetition of God's glory. And so, are you ready to dive in? Let me tell you kind of what the four sections are going to be. I don't have a lot of notes tonight, but in the first three chapters is the call of Ezekiel, okay? Chapters 4 to 24 is all about God's judgment on Jerusalem. We saw a similar kind of a outline in when Isaiah and Jeremiah preached. What you see is kind of a typical pattern through the major prophets, especially, is the judgment on the call of the prophet. Remember, we learned about the call of Jeremiah, the call of Isaiah. That's kind of what we see at the beginning of the book. But then it talks about judgment. In other books, we learned about judgment on Israel and judgment on Judah in the southern kingdom. Well, this is a similar kind of a deal. It's not so much focused on the northern kingdom as much as the southern kingdom of Judah. And so judgment on Jerusalem makes up about 20 chapters. And then God's judgment on the nations. There's a handful of chapters, verses 25 to 32, where God deals with the surrounding nations. God used the surrounding nations as his instruments of divine chastening of his people. But listen, it doesn't mean they were getting off the hook. In fact, they would scoff and mock, and they would sort of, you know, arrogantly brag about the fact that they were conquering God's people, but God's going to deal with them too. In fact, some of them don't even exist today. You know, have you seen a Philistine lately? You know, there's a lot of these nations that God just wiped out. And then the last thing is God's restoration of his people. So that's going to be kind of the big picture over the next few weeks. We're going to look at the first few chapters tonight, God's call of Ezekiel. And so, again, at the age of 30, when he could have started serving in the temple, Ezekiel was called to serve as God's prophet in Babylon. And what a calling. You know, you're excited, you're looking forward, you're a young Jewish boy, and now you're a young Jewish man, and you're looking forward to serving in the temple. That would have been something he was looking forward to. But as God brought judgment on the nation, all of a sudden, he was being deported. He was going to be taken and used of God somewhere else. And, I'll tell you, that's kind of a hard thing to adjust to. I remember when I got sick years ago and went through my bout with cancer, I remember thinking that ministry was just all done, you know? And God said, no, I'm just moving you to the hospital, John. So for a couple of years, I was in and out of hospitals for, you know, just going through that. But I remember that adjustment because I looked forward so much. I just love what I do. I love pastoring. I love serving in the church. And for so many years, that's what I did. And then it was like, oh, we're moving over here. And I'm like, oh, are you sure this is a good idea, God? You know, and this is a terrible idea. What are you doing? And, and then I saw in time that was exactly, you know, that God was in it, that God was working through that. And I thank the Lord for it now. But I can only imagine what it was like for poor Ezekiel, you know, to spend all of those years in captivity. And God says, no, you're still going to be in full-time ministry. We're just going to change locations. And the Lord, I'll tell you, he never does things the way we plan. Have you noticed? It's a bummer sometimes. But in the end, we see that it's good. So he was in captivity. But even in captivity, God allowed him to see his glory. And that's what we're going to see as we open up the story. Now it came to pass, verse 1, in the 30th year, in the fourth month, on the fifth day of the month, as I was among the captives by the river Kabar, that the heavens were opened, and I saw visions of God. On the fifth day of the month, which is in the fifth year of King Jehoiakim's captivity, the word of the Lord came expressly to Ezekiel the priest, the son of Buzi, in the land of the Chaldeans by the river Kabar, and the hand of the Lord was upon him there. Then I looked, and behold, a whirlwind was coming out of the north, a great cloud with raging fire engulfing itself, and brightness was all around it and radiating out of its midst like the color of amber out of the midst of fire. Also from within it came the likeness of four living creatures, and this was their appearance. They had the likeness of a man. Each one had four faces, and each one had four wings. Their legs were straight, and the soles of their feet were like the soles of calves' feet. They sparkled like the color of burnished bronze. The hands of a man were under their wings on their four sides, and each of the four had faces and wings. Their wings touched one another. The creatures did not turn when they went, but each one went straight forward. As for the likeness of their faces, each had the face of a man. Each of the four had the face of a lion on the right side. Each of the four had the face of an ox on the left side. And each of the four had the face of an eagle. Thus were their faces. Their wings stretched upward. Two wings of each one touched one another, and two covered their bodies, and each one went straight forward. They went wherever the Spirit wanted to go, and they did not turn when they went. As for the likeness of the living creatures, their appearance was like burning coals of fire, like the appearance of torches going back and forth among the living creatures. The fire was bright, and out of the fire went lightning, and the living creatures ran back and forth in appearance like a flash of lightning. Now as I looked at the living creatures, behold, a wheel was on the earth beside each living creature with its four faces. The appearance of the wheels and their workings was like the color of beryl, and all four had the same likeness. The appearance of their workings was, as it were, a wheel in the middle of a wheel. When they moved, they went toward any one of four directions. They did not turn aside when they went. As for their rims, they were so high they were awesome, and their rims were full of eyes all around the four of them. When the living creatures went, the wheels went beside them. And when the living creatures were lifted up from the earth, the wheels were lifted up. Wherever the Spirit wanted to go, they went, because there the Spirit went. And the wheels were lifted together with them, for the Spirit of the living creatures was in the wheels. When those went, these went. When those stood, these stood. And when those were lifted up from the earth, the wheels were lifted up together with them, for the Spirit of the living creatures was in the wheels." Wow. Are you confused? I must confess, every time I read the visions of the prophets, I just sort of, it staggers and boggles my mind. I try to picture this and I'm going, it's like nothing I've ever seen. I remember scuba diving down really deep one time, and it was a night dive. And all these creatures come out at night when you're diving in the ocean. And there's actually things in certain parts of the world, especially this is true in the tropics, you will see things, creatures, that you've never seen before. And they defy description. And yet they're real. And they're right there. And you're going, what is that? It's not a fish. It's not a shell. It's not a whale. You know, you just don't have a category for it. And you're watching this colorful life form just with incredible, you know, and you're just going, whoa, it's just incredible. And that, of course, is very different than what we're seeing here, but the point is that there are things that God has created, and there are things about God himself and about heaven itself that would just boggle our minds if we saw it. We just get glimpses of this stuff in the scripture, and words fail. You can tell that a lot of the language is saying, well, this is like that, and this is like this, and language just fails those who are describing. You read in the book of Revelation, there's a lot of similarity to the descriptions that you see John the Apostle give in Revelation to what Ezekiel says in this book, and it's just, it's kind of fun, but just kind of bizarre in a way to read these descriptions. But there's some themes here that I just want to point out as we go through. And again, we're not going to go through, you know, and unpack every verse, but just some things to keep in mind, some principles that I think are really important. The first idea that I want to pull out of this chapter is just that Ezekiel saw God's providence, and the vision shows how God is working in his world. And we're going to see we saw in the first part, he describes sort of like a storm, and God's working through this whole scene. The wheels are spinning within wheels, and the living creature is going back and forth like lightning. And you just can't really fathom what it is. And yet there's this clear sense that God, you're seeing something of the glory of God, something in this heavenly vision, and God's using this, and God is totally in control. One of the things that's interesting to me is the angelic beings described are said to have four faces: the face of a man, of a lion, of an ox, and of an eagle. Now, many Bible commentators talk about these also reference the four characteristics of Jesus that are described in the four Gospels. It's really fascinating. For example, Matthew describes Jesus as the Messiah or the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Mark shows Jesus as the servant, as depicted by the ox. Ox was a beast of burden, was made for service. Luke shows Jesus as a man. In the Gospel of Luke, you see Jesus as the Son of Man. And John, the Gospel of John, declares Jesus as God, as depicted by the eagle. So it's just really, really interesting. Again, John the Apostle in Revelation 4:7, he sees a similar thing. He says, the first living creature was like a lion, the second living creature like a calf, the third living creature had a face like a man, and the fourth living creature was like a flying eagle. So consistency throughout the scripture. Another thing that he saw is God's throne. Verses 22 to 27, I'm not going to read them right now just for the sake of time, but far above the storm and far above the wheels and the living creatures and the firmament is God's throne. And God is still on his throne. And one of the things that I read in my study, just one commentator said this. He said, the next time you face a storm, look high enough to see God's exalted throne. I thought that was a pretty neat picture. Here you're just seeing just this storm, and then above it, God on the throne. So he's, as bizarre as the picture looks, don't miss the point. You're seeing something of heaven and something of the glory of God, and just the fact that God is God. He's on the throne, and he's exalted. And so this is Ezekiel's vision. And verse 25, a voice came from above the firmament that was over their heads. Wherever they stood, they let down their wings. And above the firmament over their heads was the likeness of a throne, in appearance like a sapphire stone. On the likeness of the throne was a likeness with the appearance of a man high above it. Also from the appearance of his waist and upward, I saw as it were the color of amber with the appearance of fire all around within it. And from the appearance of his waist and downward, I saw as it were the appearance of fire with brightness all around, like the appearance of a rainbow in a cloud on a rainy day. So was the appearance of the brightness all around it. This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. So when I saw it, I fell on my face, and I heard a voice of one speaking. Man, again, what happened when people saw the glory of God in Scripture? It was pretty much the same in every case. They fell on their face. So whatever it was, I just think it was awesome. This rainbow, usually you see the rainbow when the storm is over. Ezekiel saw the rainbow during the storm, and it completely encircled the throne, a symbol of God's grace. The rainbow assures us that the Lord is with us, will not forsake us, especially when we're going through a storm. You going through any storms in your life of late? It's just amazing to remember the promises of the grace of God. I don't know what it is lately. I've been seeing rainbows everywhere. Have you guys noticed, like in the last year, I've probably seen a dozen rainbows. I don't remember seeing so many rainbows. And I've been seeing double rainbows. I just thank you, Lord, for a double dose of your grace. It's a cool thing. Well, we see in chapter 20, or chapter 2, getting ahead of myself. And he said to me, Son of man, stand on your feet, and I will speak to you. Then the Spirit entered me when he spoke to me and set me on my feet, and I heard him who spoke to me. So after this vision comes a voice, and that really is the way it ought to be. God's word endures after the memory of visions fades, and here God sets him up on his feet, and he says, okay, I got to tell you, I'm going to tell you something, listen up. And so here he is. He says in verse 3, and he said to me, son of man, I'm sending you to the children of Israel, to a rebellious nation that has rebelled against me. They and their fathers have transgressed against me to this very day, for they are impudent and stubborn children. I'm sending you to them, and you shall say to them, thus says the Lord God, as for them, whether they hear or whether they refuse, for they are a rebellious house, yet they will know that a prophet has been among them. And you, son of man, do not be afraid of them, nor be afraid of their words. Though briars and thorns are with you, and you dwell among scorpions, do not be afraid of their words, or dismayed by their looks, though they are a rebellious house. You shall speak my words to them, whether they hear or whether they refuse, for they are rebellious. But you, son of man, hear what I say to you. Do not be rebellious like the rebellious house. Open your mouth and eat what I give you. Now when I looked, there was a hand stretched out to me, and behold, a roll of a book was in it. Then he spread it before me, and there was writing on the inside and on the outside, and written on it were lamentations and mourning and woe. It's an amazing thing. He is being called to be a watchman for the nation. He is being called to be a spokesperson for God. He is stood up on his feet, he's filled with the Spirit, and he listened to the Word of God. And we're going to see here that something that I think is super important for us to know just as ambassadors for Christ. First of all, we need to feed on the Word of God. Chapter 3, he said, son of man, eat what you find. Eat this scroll and go speak to the house of Israel. So I opened my mouth and he caused me to eat that scroll. And he said to me, son of man, feed your belly and fill your stomach with this scroll that I give you. So I ate and it was in my mouth like honey in sweetness. And then he said to me, go to the house of Israel and speak my words to them. And so Ezekiel was told to speak the word of the Lord. But did you notice, it wasn't his responsibility to convince people to turn from their sin. And that's really important, because as spokesmen for the Lord, as people who know the Word of God and understand his message, we are called to proclaim the truth of God. And notice he's called to his people. Now we know, we've been learning in fact on Sunday, that we're called to reach the world, right? The nations. With the gospel, go to every people, tribe, tongue, and nation. We're to go into Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. So we know that in this New Testament age that God wants to reach the whole world. But it's interesting, Ezekiel is called to declare the word to his people. And I point this out because I wonder how many of you, if you were honest, would rather go to strangers and go to the world than go to your own family. I'm not that you don't want to reach your family, but in the sense that it's scary and it's hard, isn't it? Because a lot of times those people that know us the best, they're the hardest people to reach with the gospel message. They're the hardest people to convince of God's love. And Ezekiel is being called to his people, and they're people that are probably pretty grumpy. They're people that are in captivity for their sin. And God tells them ahead of time, they are rebellious. Don't you dare be rebellious like them. You go do what I tell you to do. You go say what I say. And don't worry about what they say to you. Don't worry whether they receive it or not. He says, in fact, don't even get too hung up on the way they look at you. It's amazing how just the countenance of a person can just scare us to death. And then we chicken out before we even say five words, just by the look on their face, or maybe just the imagination of what this good look on their face is going to be. And we just, it's so scary to be a spokesperson for the Lord, especially to our own people, because we're afraid of rejection. I am. To this day, it's hard for me to speak to certain members of my family because I just feel like they're just going to reject me again, you know. And but Ezekiel is told, "Hey, go do it." And so I think it's really important for us to learn. Don't be discouraged if people don't listen. Just do what God tells you to do. And notice he eats this scroll. Now remember, this is not literal interpret. This is figurative language. I think in the vernacular, we would say it like this. Oh, she just devoured that book. Have you ever used that term? You know, I love to read. I just devoured that book or that series or whatever. And the idea is that you absorb the contents. And so whatever God was making known and revealing to Ezekiel, he wanted him to internalize it. And the reason it was sweet is because when God speaks to us, that's a sweet thing. You ever hear from God? It's exciting. It's a wonderful thing that God, when God reveals something to you, it's a sweet thing to hear from the Lord. But the message sometimes is a hard message. And that's why it says it's also bitter. It became like bitterness in his stomach. It was sweet to eat because it was the word of God, and yet it was bitter because it was a hard message. It was going to be really hard to say, to share this message of judgment and the realization that there were bitter consequences. I find today that a lot of times sermons are sort of put together to stir people emotionally, you know. Sometimes, there are people that are very eloquent speakers, very gifted, very charismatic, very entertaining, very funny. And they're enjoyable to listen to, but that doesn't necessarily mean they're really speaking for the Lord. If you go away from a message and you go, oh, that was the funniest thing I ever heard, and you just go on and on talking about just how incredible that person was in their delivery and their wit and their humor and their this and their that, then they're probably not really preaching the word of God. And those things don't help you in life, really. Entertainment doesn't help you through trials of life. It doesn't give you wisdom. It doesn't give you understanding. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with being, you know, funny or entertaining or engaging. I think great teachers, you know, the best ones. I have some favorite teachers. I just love listening to them. They're just really great communicators. But the reason I keep listening to them isn't for that. I listen to them because they're pointing me to Jesus. I listen to them because they're just pointing. Their passion is to help me understand truth. And that's really what I'm interested in. That's what I want to sort of really absorb and digest and see worked out in my life. Only the word of God can feed your spirit. What I have to say, and that goes for me too, by the way. What I have to say doesn't matter. It's what God has to say that really matters. And so he says, hey, just use my words. And there's an interesting, go down to verse 4, where did it go? Hang on, I'll find it. I lost the verse. In my notes, one of the things that I found it. Yeah, I was right, verse 15. He says, "Then I came to the captives at Tel Abib who dwelt by the river Kabar, and I sat where they sat and remained there, astonished among them 7 days. And then, what to me jumped out on this is just the fact that it's so important to sit with people that you're going to minister to kind of spend time just being with them, to understand them. Sometimes I find that when I look at people's actions, the way they're behaving, I can get frustrated, maybe even angry at times, or just kind of find it repulsive. But I have learned, and I remember my mom taught me this when I was a young boy. She always said, "Johnny, remember, there's always reasons why people behave the way they do. And if you knew their story, if you had their life experience, in other words, if people are mean to you, if people are, you know, just angry and just troublemaker, pray for them and have compassion for them. because, and she was so right. What I found is as I would try to get to know those people, I would find that they just had horrible life experiences. And all of a sudden I had compassion for them. And I think in ministry, and as we represent the Lord, we need to take time to sit where other people sit. In that sense, take time to learn about their background, learn about what they've been through, the things, the kind of pressures they're facing. And what I find is oftentimes I'll go from being mad to being sad and having a heart of compassion. And the other thing I like about this that's instructive to me is before Ezekiel set out on his ministry, he took time to just sit and listen, just spend time with the people. These people are in captivity. He goes and sits by the river with them, and he hears their story, and he talks with them, and he gets to know them. And he was careful to listen and to observe. And that's important for me because, you know, sometimes I can speak before I listen and before I really have compassion. You know, I feel like, well, they need to hear this, or I think I need to say that, you know. Do you ever do that where as someone's talking, you're already thinking of what you're going to say before they're done, and you haven't even really listened? I'm probably the only one who's ever done that, but I'll just confess that there. It's so instructive to just be reminded, to just sit and listen and observe. And the next verses tell us he's a watchman. It came to pass at the end of 7 days, verse 16, that the word of the Lord came to me saying, Son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel. Therefore, hear a word from my mouth and give them warning from me. And so, you know, another thing that I think was important is, you know, in this is we sometimes run ahead of God. And it's just important to wait and to only speak when he speaks. Ezekiel knew he had been called to a difficult time. He knew that he had been called to do a difficult work. And he was called to work with a difficult people. I was talking with a pastor the other day from the Midwest, and he was telling me about what ministry is like in certain places in the Midwest. And he was just saying, man, it's really, really hard. You could plant a church in some little podunk town, and you can be there for 25 years, and your congregation never grows to be more than 25 people. And he says, it's just really, really hard. And yet, you know, God calls people to difficult places like that to share his word and sometimes deal with difficult people. Now, as we come into chapter 4 and 5, what we're going to see is that Ezekiel begins his public ministry with these kind of action sermons or these object lessons, and all of them are intended to basically declare God's judgment against Jerusalem. And the first thing he does, and guys, you'll like this. Remember when you were a little boy? How many of you had the little green army men? I'm just curious. Any little green army men? They still make those? I think they do. I remember as a little kid playing with those and just lining them all up. And this is kind of what Ezekiel gets to do. He gets to play army. He gets to play war. And he says, you also, son of man, take a clay tablet and lay it before you and portray on it a city, Jerusalem. Lay siege against it. Build a siege wall against it and heap up a mound against it. Set camps against it also and place battering rams against it all around. Moreover, take for yourself an iron plate and set it as an iron wall between you and the city. Set your face against it and it shall be besieged and you shall lay siege against it. This will be a sign to the house of Israel. And so he gets to play war. And this iron plate is supposed to be a picture of a barrier. There is a barrier between God and his people. And nothing was going to stop Babylon from capturing the city. And he wanted them to know it. Again, their prophets, their false prophets were telling them, no danger, peace, peace, it's okay, don't panic. And God was saying, you had better start being afraid because it's going to happen. And then, in fact, he even does a little math here. He says, lie also on your left side and lay the iniquity of the house of Israel upon it. According to the number of the days that you lie on it, you shall bear their iniquity, for I have laid on you the years of their iniquity. According to the number of the days, 390 days. So you shall bear the iniquity of the house of Israel. And when you have completed them, lie again on your right side. Then you shall bear the iniquity of the house of Judah 40 days. I have laid on you a day for each year. Can you imagine? Okay, Ezekiel, I want you to lay on your right side. Okay, Lord, how long? 390 days. That would be a really hard deal. I don't know, and I don't know that anybody. Was that like 24/7, or was that just, you know, is that an 8-hour workday, God? can I get up and stretch and sleep in my bed at the end of the day? I mean, we just don't really know. I kind of suspect that it was probably just for a day at a time, and then 40 days. But again, it was an object lesson. It was showing both Israel and Judah their sin, how long suffering God was during those years, and how they had sinned against Him. And then he goes to the next object lesson, and he says, also take for yourself, verse 9, wheat, barley, beans, lentils, millet, and spelt. Put them into one vessel and make bread of them for yourself. During the number of days that you lie on your side, 390 days, you shall eat it. And your food which you eat shall be by weight, 20 shekels a day. From time to time you shall eat it. You shall also drink water by measure, 1/6 of a hin from the time you shall drink. And you shall eat it as barley cakes and bake it using the fuel of human waste in their sight. And the Lord said, so shall the children of Israel eat their defiled bread among the Gentiles where I will drive them. I mean, this is pretty brutal stuff. But again, remember, God had put up that with them for centuries. And they had committed the worst atrocities. It's tempting to think that God's just going a little overboard here. But you have to realize, he has watched his people. We'll see as we go through the book. They became spiritual harlots. They had committed idolatry, which was the equivalent of adultery in God's eyes. He looked at them as they were like, oh, like today in the New Testament, we are called the bride of Christ. And the Jews were espoused to God. They were his people, his bride. And they had forsaken him, and they chased after other lovers. They chased after the gods of the other heathen nations around them. And so this had gone on for so long, and God finally said, that's it. Time's up. And so he's depicting for them just how long suffering he had been, but judgment was coming. And so for those 14 months and 10 days, Ezekiel had to ration his food and water, as the people in Jerusalem would do as well. And Ezekiel did it. The fourth sign that he gives is to shave himself, his head and his face. This was a real sacrifice for a Jew. And the hair basically represented the people in Jerusalem who faced three destinies. Okay, I'm not going to read the verses. You can finish out that chapter. But basically death by famine, death by sword, and then dispersion among the nations. But again, there is going to be a believing remnant that would be protected and saved by the Lord. And so God had always protected and provided for Judah. He was patient. He did everything he could to get them to repent, and they wouldn't. And so we see in verse 8 of chapter 5 these words. Notice this. He says, I, even I, am against you and will execute judgments in your midst in the sight of the nations. And I will do among you what I've never done, and the like of which I will never do again, because of all your abominations. And so you really got to think twice before you decide to make God an enemy and resist him. Don't test his patience, because if you go on long enough against God, you're gonna find that he will go against you. Okay, can I do this? Yes, I can. I'm going to do 6 and 7 real quick. We'll be done in about 3 minutes here. Chapter 6, the first few verses. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, set your face toward the mountains of Israel and prophesy against them and say, O mountains of Israel, hear the word of the Lord God. Thus says the Lord God to the mountains, to the hills, to the ravines, and to the valleys. Indeed, I, even I, will bring a sword against you, and I will destroy your high places. So the high places was where they would set up these altars and sacrifice to pagan gods. So they had started to do that. Even when they were in exile, even with their captive, they still didn't get the get the lesson. They didn't learn their lesson, and so they were still doing this. And he's basically saying that your whole system is going to be destroyed, and the people with it. In verses 8 to 10, he says, "Yet I will leave a remnant, so that you may have some who escape the sword among the nations when you are scattered through the countries. And those of you who escape will remember me among the nations where they were carried captive, because I was crushed by their adulterous heart, which has departed from me." And so the signs are over now, and Ezekiel gives them two sermons. Judgment was coming, and this place is going to be wiped out, but yet in grace, God would spare a remnant that would remember him and repent of their sins. And that's an amazing thing to look at Israel. Can you believe that in 1948, they were reborn as a nation after being 2,000 years out of their homeland? It's just crazy. How, I mean, it's miraculous. It's only God. I mean, that people say, well, how do you know that the scripture is true? And how can you trust the Bible? And I have one word, Israel. You know, it's an amazing thing that they maintain their national identity and even their language and their faith and all of these things. It's just an amazing thing, because God always has a remnant that are faithful, and he prophesied that would happen. Daniel was carried away to Babylon. We're going to see that, and yet he purposed in his heart that he would not be defiled, and he was a light for the Lord in Babylon. And God has his remnant today as well. And this is just what I leave you with to think of. Two more thoughts. Just basically to be that light in the world. Think about where you live. Think about where you work. Think about where you go to school. God puts you there, like a Daniel, to be a light in that dark place. And at the end of chapter 7, I want to draw your attention just to this phrase. I think four times I underlined in chapter 7, he says, an end. The end has come upon the four corners of the land. Now the end has come upon you, and I will send my anger against you. I will judge you according to your ways. I will repay you for all your abominations. I will repay your ways. And then it says, and then you shall know that I am the Lord. Again, that's the big idea. God is God. He says, then you will know. But he says, I will repay four times all the things Judah trusted in that brought them to the place, the place where they're at, aren't going to help them. They trusted in money. They trusted in idols. They trusted in their leaders. And God finally says, hey, that's it. The end has come. You're going to know that I'm God. And so, kind of heavy, but I think still very instructive for us today in a lot of practical ways. So we're going to stop there. We'll pick up chapter 8 next time. Let's stand together. And we're going to sing a closing song. And let me pray. Lord, thank you for tonight. Thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, that even though it's a sober series of books that we're going through, it's also instructive, it's corrective, and it's hopeful. Lord, we're thankful that we can pick out principles along the way that just remind us that we are here for a reason, and we are to be a light to others around us. And even if we're going through times of chastening, we know that it's your mercy that gives us a chance to repent. And thank you, Lord, that you give us hope. It's not always going to be this way. And Lord, help us to be bold, that we would speak your word and we wouldn't be discouraged or dissuaded from sharing the truth in love and preaching the gospel of grace and even warning of judgment, but not doing it in an arrogant, prideful, sort of damning way, but just even with humility and grace, pleading with people to turn to the Lord. Lord, help us not worry about the look on their face or the tone of their voice or what they say or do. Help us to be like Ezekiel and just obey your command to do it, knowing that it comes from a heart of love. Help us have that same heart of love. And Lord, if you're dealing with our sin, I pray that you would help us also to repent. Help us to trust in your forgiveness and your grace to help us change and grow. And we ask this in Christ's name. Amen.